Generative type setting is a name for a relatively old-fashioned process, or at least incorporating old-fashioned processes that has been re-implemented using modern tools. So utilizes visually semantic markup. Does anybody recognize this? Okay, so that's markdown for italics. It goes back to times of dedicated word processing machines. This is, I forget the name of the hardware itself, but it was the first one that could do Japanese typesetting. So at that point, it required like a mini computer, and it was a single person's job, like maybe in an academic department, to typeset all the documents for the department. Donald Knuth, in 1978, there was a second edition. Maybe everybody knows this history anyway. But in 1978, the typesetting industry was really shifting from hot press, like laid out lead was largely gone, but the electronic systems hadn't really caught up. And he wasn't happy with the way that his art of computer programming was going to look. The second edition of the second volume. But one thing Tech didn't have was really like a semantic understanding of the document. It was typesetting. So Brian Reed developed a system called Scribe, which was sort of a watershed moment for typesetting, at least in the sense that it was concerned with letting the computer know exactly when or exactly what the semantic structure of the document was. So here you have heading, and then a quotation, and this kind of would allow style to come in later. So it took a very short amount of time before someone decided, or, well, Leslie Lamport, not just somebody, decided to incorporate this sort of idea into Tech by developing macros. And you can see it looks almost exactly the same, except that sometimes, like for instance, in LaTeX, it's very common to use backticks to represent left quotes, and so it doesn't do total. It's not completely semantic, but it's a lot better than the original Tech. The idea was that you could restyle it however you wanted. With a separation of style and content. Fortunately, that's not always the case. I'll get back to that later. Then semantic markup kind of goes through some evolution, and there's a really great series called Crockford on JavaScript that he spends a lot of time actually talking about the evolution of semantic markup. It's a really great series. It goes back to the beginning of the history of computing. So it's worth more than just JavaScript. Anyway, so it goes from SGML to HTML and finally to XML. As these systems get more general and computable, they lose the traction, like our minds lose traction on them as well. I mean, yes, you can see the structure, but it's not immediately apparent exactly. You have to look at what's between these angle brackets in order to understand what is supposed to happen to the document. So that's where Markdown comes in. Markdown is one of the first pre-formats developed by John Gruber and Aaron Schwartz in the early 2000s. And it was enabled by Perl regular expressions, which were sort of also a watershed in text processing. Which allowed basically, yeah, visually semantic markup that had sort of evolved over decades of emails. So it's, yeah, so it's based around, you look at it, and there, okay, this is italics. If I wanted to do bold, I would do like two asterisks, headers with hashtags. Anyway, then a lot more pre-formats come out, restructured text, Textile, Wiki, Wikimedia, MediaWiki. But in my opinion, a new approach is necessary. And this is because of my experience with dealing with multiple output formats. Usually, Markdown was meant to just simply translate into HTML. There's been some nice developments. A tool called Pandoc. I don't know, has ever people heard of Pandoc? Yeah, it's beautiful. It's just, I don't want to learn Haskell. I'm sorry. So to script it, it comes back and you have to do a lot of glue code, which I'll show later. And LaTeX fades away because, okay, yeah, the typographic workflows are so variable that, when it's not some kind of standardized style already set, it can be really difficult to sort of imagine what it's supposed to be or take one set of content and shift it. So even when there's a supposedly a separation, it's not always that easy in practice. My proposal is Subtext, called Subtext. There's a programming language called Subtext, but I'm ignoring that because it seems to be dead. And the idea is a mutable translation layer. So what I'm doing is I'm separating the front end and the back end. So you have style and you have effect, and you can swap either one out. And I'll show you how that works in a second. The input files gain access to multiple output formats. Whatever you want to build an effect file for, you can output into. But now their agency also includes, so you can have HTML, but you could have a setup where that content is a main article, or it could turn into a sidebar, or it could turn into, any number of things just based on swapping out the effect without having to change the style at all. And part of the reason why style needs to be reconfigurable is because you want to have flexibility in the way that you model it yourself. And so you can, Subtext has the ability to hold Markdown, restructure text, all of them together. So the architecture is, I'm writing it in Lua. This is because the table system there is really super flexible for this. But we can also eventually abstract away from writing the tables directly to something more like CSS. I'm a big fan of context. I use it. I'm a member of the new board that we're starting for user group. And it's the primary PDF backend because it's a lot more configurable than LaTeX in terms of style. But there's nothing stopping LaTeX from being part of the new equation. So here's a preliminary syntax. These are Lua tables. So in style, you say header. It starts with a hash mark. It stops with a hash mark. And inline no means it's just on a single line. And this is, I'm still kind of working out the actual words. So then in the effect file, you can write, you take whatever's matched as header. You declare the format, but this could be outside of the table, just recognized as like, okay, this is the context effects file. So this could be left out eventually. This is the setup. And then you have to tell at some point in the file where the setup stuff goes in the final. Start is subject, stop is bracket. So what goes between here goes between here. Same with HTML. And this means 16 point small caps, which is sort of weird, but anyway. Text, do the same. I didn't change the size. And you give the H1 a class of small caps. Now what you could do is if you wanted to define a new type of header, you could have percent marks, you could have one that starts with a hash mark, ends with a percent mark, stuff like this that for individual document workflows, you can customize it to your heart's content. One of the advantages is future-proofing. You're not, like, if the language changes underneath your feet, like the output formats change underneath your feet, to swap in a new effects file. You can reset, that's you just reset whatever you, like I was talking about, the way that the, you can have an article format, this is a good one, like screen PDF versus print PDF, so you could have sans serifs and a different sort, and half of a 1920 by 1080 monitor as your page, ebooks, all that stuff. Again, no change to the content. So here's contact information. I haven't really gotten any of this started yet, like actually implemented, but I've been developing the architecture in terms of planning the engineering for about 16 months. So I just wanted to show like what right now what a generative typesetting workflow requires. So this I wrote my thesis on this. What? Okay, that's weird. Sorry? This isn't so important. This is gonna be one command. So I wrote the thesis in something like this. I like the idea of being able to just completely be surrounded by the text. And here's, you can see the markdown and the style. Maybe I can make this bigger. No, it just requires extra config that I don't have time for right now. But you eventually, when you're dealing with Pandoc, this is another great option. This is Scribes. And you can see that it sort of does syntax highlighting for section headers here. And then also when you have... Yeah, it italicizes what's in between. So this is nice. I want something like this for the eventual interface of subtext. So this is you have these template files that sort of you set up. These are your setups. You have to put them in by hand. Not really syntax highlighted. They're also the editor is really confused about what kind of file this is. So these are just normal context setups, and they're super flexible. But it would be nice if you really didn't have to worry about them if you didn't want to. And also, I don't really like dealing with things that mix logics like that. Like, I'd rather just have, I'd rather be defining my setups within the configuration rather than in some sort of template. And so I wrote this script called Thesis Groomer because you have, in order for the abstract to be typeset in context, I needed to start. I had to have an abstract environment. But in order for that to make any sense to the HTML version, I basically had to turn it into a command line variable that was passed in. So this entire set of text is passed in every time I run the program Pandoc, and in the different template files, it's arranged in specific locations. So obviously that's it would be nice if I could just be like, this symbol means begin abstract, this symbol means end abstract. And they could be symbols, they can be phrases and symbols, whatever. So it's clearly not the best right now. But it works at the same time. But we'll have... we'll have it in just a few seconds. We already have the HTML version right here. So here's the HTML version, which I didn't give as much tender love and care as the tech version because it was the PDF one that really mattered in the end.
want that. So yeah, as you can see, there's a lot of nice, yeah, also this poem to some friends I lost, that needed special, you know, massaging. And so it would be really nice if you didn't have to write these like glue scripts and pass in, I don't know how many characters this is on a command line. We'll get to the contents soon. Well, whatever. Anyway, so this is the basic idea. Context makes beautiful PDFs. One of the reasons why it's better than LaTeX, in my opinion, is that it's a small core that has a lot more flexibility. So it's not about, like, LaTeX has a lot of problems with module clashing and all that kind of stuff. But yeah, so just I'll put my info back up. And let me know if you want to participate or anything like that. Well, it's kind of gone, but whatever. So we'll move on to questions.
Questions, comments?
Yes.
Hi, that's a cool looking system. I just had a question about the syntax. It looks like if you pass in a subject which has a curly brace in it, you'll end up generating tech with invalid syntax. Is that correct?
That's an important consideration. Like, it has to do sort of a pre-processing, like basically just setting up an LPEG system in Lua. There's like a really nice parsing engine, and you can basically, before anything happens, you can you know, turn it into a HTML specific character, or you know, something that's safe for context.
So I have a very simple question, which is that the default output for context, like in both the HTML and the PDF, or are those like special templates you put together?
Oh, they're special templates. The
Have you made those available? Because they look really slick.
Thanks. It's actually I'm sort of just implementing Robert Bringhurst. One stage at a time, and that's actually a plan of mine, is to make that available as a context module, so that you can just say use module Bringhurst, and then there it all is. So,
cool.
Yeah, I'll keep you posted.
I have another question here.
Yeah, my question was also basically related to the fear of escaping characters, but also to the degree of like, how do you almost like describe, if you need to like almost write an example of how to use this context in context.
Right.
So the moment you actually have like almost like code examples, or what do you in HTML would have as like pre-formatted text, which is like monospace, like code example, have you like given that kind of aspect of it consideration?
Yeah, I mean, that would be, I mean, I could show you real quickly what that would look like. It's just, you know, for instance, in Markdown, or at least the Pandoc version of Markdown, it's percentage signs all across for like 8 or something, and then another 8 percentage signs. So in context, you just use start typing, and that puts you into a non-parsed environment that tech ignores all the stuff that's in it, and it also breaks into the monospace font. So and you can also do setups for like what the size of what appears in start typing is, and it should have nice line breaking in it as well, but that's sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, because context is a moving target. It's actually in beta right now. It was stable, and then they're rewriting the whole thing in LuaTeX. Like, LuaTeX is a new engine that's based on language support, which is basically a whole rewrite of the tech engine. So they basically embedded Lua, and they're sort of like cannibalizing it from the inside, rewriting everything. But yeah, to answer the question, so you could just have like a pre-tag or a code tag as your start-stop for HTML, and start typing, stop typing. But if you wanted to use, for instance, a pretty printer, right, you could implement something they have, there's a module for that in context as well. So then, like, again, that's more flexible than something like Pandoc. For me, because I don't know Haskell, it's easier to sort of just say, okay, start typing Ruby, and that's like an environment that you set up And it has it uses Vim syntax highlighting rules, prints your code that way.
Other questions?
One of the big advantages for me for using LaTeX at the time when I was using it was including graphics with text which was styled in LaTeX format. Doing this with Inkscape as an example now?
That's interesting. We use Inkscape to convert our SVGs to PDF when we embed them, for instance. Like it's just it uses that. So if you don't have it installed, it's sort of problematic. But no, I mean it's like if you include a figure that's in SVG format, we just use Inkscape and print it back. I just mentioned that because
the idea would be
no.
You type a text in Inkscape, you save it as SVG, and you can type formats rules which will be read by context. With Xfig, you could put formats in there which will be read by LaTeX, which includes the graphics you were doing. This makes that your graphics look like the text you're typing. That's
right.
A big advantage.
I'm a little confused as to what system were you using in LaTeX? LaTeX and Inkscape. Okay, we use like MetaPost, which is turned into a library. Yeah, because I'm sure basically anything that's possible in LaTeX is possible in context, if not more. So
we'll continue this one afterwards.
Okay. Anything else?
Other questions, comments, suggestions? Thank you, Dan.
Thank you. I'll mute for a second.